Take a look at these two sequences of 20 coin tosses. One of them is the result of real coin tosses, and the other is a fake. Can you guess which one is which? At first, you might think they both look equally random. But it turns out that you can analyze these in a way that makes it seem very likely that one is random, and seem very likely that the other is not. It's important that we say it seems random, because it's impossible for us to tell with absolute certainty that one or the other is fake, because both are possible random coin flips. To start to get a sense of how this works, let's look at a simpler problem. Let's say that your friend is flipping a coin. Their first flip is a head, and then their second flip is a head. At this point, everything seems normal, but then a third, fourth, and fifth head appear. As you start to see the sequence of heads grow longer and longer, you will start to get suspicious of your friend. Maybe they're being honest, but every time you see another head, it makes you question their honesty just a little bit more. But why would you do this? What is making you think that something is wrong? Our intuition tells us that this doesn't look like a randomized coin flip anymore. Getting 10 heads out of 10 flips just seems very unusual because it's so far from what we expect. We really only expect 5 heads in 10 flips. And that intuition is what starts us down the path of understanding how to detect fraud. Even though randomness doesn't have any patterns per se, we can know something about what to expect and recognize when things deviate away from that. Here are some examples of 10 coin flip patterns that don't seem to be random. In each case, there's some type of pattern that seems unrealistic if the result is supposed to be random. The regularity of patterns creates predictability, which feels a lot like the opposite of randomness. When trying to figure out whether there's randomness involved in the list, it's important that we have enough data to analyze. If we think back to our friend flipping all heads, there isn't anything suspicious after the first couple heads. It's only when you have enough information that you can start to say that there's a pattern developing. In preparation for class, you're going to need to come up with two lists of 75 coin tosses. 75 is a large number, but it's important that we have enough data to really be able to look for patterns. For one list, you're going to make it up on your own, but trying to do it in a way that looks random. For the other, you're going to use a random list of coin flips generated by a computer. This can be done by going to random.org and using their virtual coin flipper. In class, we're going to see whether we can tell the difference between the faked random list and the truly random list. As important as it is to have lots of data, it can also be dangerous and deceptive. As you get more data, it becomes more likely that you will find a pattern that's a result of randomness. The probability of flipping 10 heads in a row is 1 in 1,024. This means that if someone flips a coin 10 times in a row, you would expect that one time out of 1,024 will end up with 10 heads in a row simply by chance. What happens if we have thousands of people flip a coin 10 times in a row? With enough people, you would expect to find that someone has flipped 10 heads in a row. But now let's focus on the person that got the 10 heads in a row. Does it make sense to look at them and say that they must have cheated simply because they got 10 heads in a row? If we were only watching this one person, we might be suspicious. But in the larger context of having thousands of people do this experiment, it doesn't seem suspicious at all. In fact, it's expected. So when we're looking for fraud, we need to be very careful in our approach. The rest of the pre-class activities will show you a few more ideas in fraud detection, such as Benford's Law. And in class, we will analyze the real and fake coin flips to see if we can discover accidental patterns in the fake data.